Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks.
Good morning and welcome as we gather on this Thanksgiving Sunday for 2021. And the reason why I announced the year is last year, October of Thanksgiving 2020 was the first time we opened for in-house worship since COVID started. So it's been a year, and you know, through that year, we've been open at times and closed at times, back open and closed and now back open. So it has been an interesting year for us in our in-house worship, but for many of you who have been journeying with us through our online worship, you've been noticing that, you know, we have been consistent, we have been faithful in offering this gift each and every Sunday. As you can see behind me, we have the communion table so beautifully decorated for the Thanksgiving season. Hopefully you're seeing it and enjoying that, and I hope that you're going to have a very wonderful and blessed Thanksgiving this year. As I mentioned in the last couple weeks, we do have our shoe boxes for Samaritan's Purse, Operation Christmas Child. So if you would like a shoe box, just let us know and we'll be able to make arrangements to be at the church sometime for you to pick it up. Or if you need us to drop it off, we'd be glad to do that too. They need to be in by the start of November, so we've still got a few more weeks that you can get out and buy some of the items to fill a shoe box with. And I hope that you enjoyed the communion service last Sunday. As we know it, it's always a joy when we can gather together and experience communion. So let us begin our Thanksgiving service with "Welcome to This House," followed by "Holy, Holy, Holy." Well, we've raised our voices in singing. Let's prepare our hearts for worship now with our Thanksgiving liturgy. Join together with me. O God, we come together before you today with grateful hearts and with songs and praises of thanksgiving on our lips. May our worship be in spirit and in truth. May our hearts and minds be receptive to your word. We come as your thankful people. Be with us as we worship you this day. Amen. Now we continue with our opening hymn, "We Plow the Fields and Scatter."
We plow
the fields and scatter.
let us once again sing, "We Come to Ask Your Forgiveness." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, here we are on Thanksgiving Sunday, and we know there is so much for us to be thankful for because you are an amazing God who never holds back any special gifts for your children. We know each and every day you provide for every need. You know each and every day you bless us with the house or the apartment or the place that we stay in. You bless us with food on our table. You bless us with friends and companions along the way. You bless us with the gift of health. And you bless us with the gifts that make up who we are. We're just so thankful each and every day, God, because you are a God who is so amazing and so faithfully provides. But it's so interesting, God, isn't it? How even though you are always so faithful, there are times when we still allow fear to enter in our walk. We sometimes question, I know you've provided before, God, but will you provide again? Or we start to wonder, will you keep it up, God? You know, with what I expect, what I hope for. Or maybe we just allow that fear to overtake us and we start to hoard or keep what we have instead of sharing it abundantly with others. You know, God, our habits and our tendencies when it comes to fear. And if fear is guiding our actions, if fear is causing us not to maybe draw closer to you, we want to bring that as a confession right now, as well as all of our confessions, because we know, God, it is so important for us to confess our sins, because we do want to be free of guilt, but we do want to change. We want to walk in a relationship with you that is forgiven and change to be more Christ-like. So God, take away our fears and our worries. Take away our sins so that we can truly experience a closer walk with you, a walk of love, a walk of grace, a walk of truth, a walk where we experience the fullness of the Christian life. We offer this prayer in Christ's name, who taught each and every one of us when to pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, our memory verse today is from Psalm 71. And the writer of Psalm 71 is anonymous. We don't know who the writer is, but as you read through the verses, it's very easy to tell that this person is up there in age. He's getting to the later stages of his life, and he's beginning to reflect on what he's learned, what he's experienced. And when he gets to verse 6, this is the observation he's had as he's looked back over the course of his life. He said, Yes, you have been with me from birth, from my mother's womb. You have cared for me. No wonder I am always praising you. So again, we don't know his age for sure, but let's say he's 60 or 70 or 80. Enough years to reflect on God's faithfulness. And as he looks back over the course of his life, he knows right from the beginning, from the time he was even in his mother's womb, that God was with him and that God was caring for him. And isn't that an amazing thing for us to always keep at the forefront? Always to remember, because we can question that at times, can't we? Because we have seasons where we feel that God is close and that God is caring, and then there's other seasons. But God doesn't change. He's cared for us from the time we've been in our mother's womb. And if we keep that at the forefront, we'll always know that God is caring for us. And what a wonderful blessing that flows out of it. Not just trust, not just greater confidence, but also to know that we will always be praising God no matter what. So I pray and hope that this memory verse will be special to you, because isn't it amazing to know from the time we have been in our mother's womb, God has always been there caring for us. A powerful memory verse. Well, for our story time and pondering time, we have so much to be thankful for, don't we? And for some of us, we would go back to our childhood and move forward to think of all the things we are thankful for. And as we start back in our childhood, we would be thankful for the parents that God has given us and the grandparents that also were part of our walk and journey. And can you remember back some of the wisdom and advice that maybe your parents or your grandparents would pass along to you when you were young? You know, some of the pieces of wisdom like, you know, make sure that you finish everything on your plate before you can have dessert. Now, that was incentive, wasn't it, for us? If we really wanted that dessert, we had to make sure that we weren't nitpicky, that we just didn't pick and choose, leave the vegetables to one side. We had to eat everything on our plate. And maybe we pass that same advice on to our children and grandchildren. Or how about this advice? It's cold outside. Make sure you don't go out without a hat on. And you remember the stories of so many people would say that they would wear the hat, but as soon as they got outside and thought they were outside mom or dad's glance, they would take the hat off and walk in the cold, you know? But good advice that our parents would give us. Or maybe, you know, don't go outside without your rain jacket on. Again, good advice that was meant to keep us safe and to protect us. But I'm sure a piece of advice that your parents gave you was to share. You know, think about a time when maybe you had two cookies in your lunch. And you knew that one of your friends had none. And you're sitting at school, you're looking at your cookies, you finished your maybe your apple and your sandwich, and all of a sudden you look at your cookies and you remember what your mom would say to you at that moment. Honey, remember to share with those who have none. And you may even remember that you took the one cookie and gave it to your friend, and then the two of you enjoyed a cookie each. Sharing. Something was taught to us by our parents. And you know, we maybe have learned all the other lessons in life that our parents have taught us, but have we truly learned that lesson when it comes to sharing? You know, because look at the abundance that we have in these days and times. Look at all the stuff we have. Look at the bountiful food we may have in our cupboards, the bountiful possessions we have, the resources, the money we have. And let me ask you, are you still carrying forward that lesson that your parents taught you to share? Because isn't that something that we think about and are encouraged to do in Thanksgiving is to be a sharing people, to continue to be generous just as God has been generous to us. And I don't know if that's a lesson that you have carried forward, but that is something I think to ponder about today. Because remember, not just our parents have taught us that lesson, but our Heavenly Father has taught us that lesson as well. And what He is maybe watching to see, is my child sharing? Is my child giving as I have given to him or her? May that be what you ponder on this Thanksgiving Sunday. Let us continue our worship now as we sing the song, Count Your Blessings, name them one by one. Shall we, in our prayer for understanding, let us pray. Heavenly Father, it is time now for us to open the Word of Scripture. And we're looking so forward to it because every time we open the pages of the Bible, we learn more and more about who you are and what you desire for us, the good things that you hope to instill in our hearts. And as we've been walking and journeying through our I Owe It series, we realize, God, that there are virtues. There are things in our hearts that maybe have been buried deep that we need to bring to the surface to be healed. And if that's the case with our topic today, God, once again, we ask that you speak very loudly and very clearly to us. Because, God, we want a heart that can keep up with faith and obedience. We want a heart that is a heart after yours. So God, be with each one of us and touch each one of us. We offer this prayer in Christ's name. Amen. Well, today we're going to be looking at greed. And greed says, I owe me. And we're going to see a story in the scriptures where Jesus talks about greed, where he gives a warning, and then he tells the story of a very rich and wealthy landowner that had an abundant crop. And what did he do with it? As we're about to see, he didn't realize that hiding beneath his heart was the problem of greed. Luke 12, verses 13 to 21 is our reading today. Someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." Jesus replied, "Man, who appointed me a judge or an arbiter between you?" Then he said to them, "Watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions." And he told them this parable. The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, "What shall I do? I have no place to store my crops." Then he said, "This is what I'll do. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones. And there I will store my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, 'You have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself?' This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves, but is not rich toward God." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, for the first couple of weeks of this series, we've been looking at qualities and attributes, haven't we, that can be very negative unless we deal with them. So we looked first at guilt. And the thing about guilt is it's so easy for us to recognize when it begins to arise and upflow in us. Because remember, guilt happens when we do something that we perceive is wrong. And it's at that moment that those guilty feelings start to flow and we recognize right away that's the emotion we are experiencing. The same is true with anger. Remember last week we looked at anger and it's easy to identify our anger. Our blood boils. Maybe we all of a sudden become flush. We grit our teeth. We clench our fists. Our voice raises and we know we're getting angry and upset. So, it's easy to recognize guilt. It's easy to recognize anger. But the problem with greed is it's not very easy to recognize. And I'm sure many of you are saying today, "You know what? I like this series, Dean, but I don't think today applies to me. I don't think there is an ounce of greed in me." But here's the problem. Greed can hide behind virtues that we think are very good and positive. And here's what I mean. Now, we say it's a good thing that we save. Now, greedy people tend to be savers. We also say it's a good virtue that we plan ahead. You know, that we think things out, that we put out a plan and follow a plan. That's a good thing. But greedy people tend to be planners as well. Or we say, you know, it's a good virtue. If you think about your retirement and you begin to prepare and plan for your retirement, but you know, greedy people tend to focus on their future and their retirement as well. So saving, planning, preparing for one's retirement are all good virtues. But here's the problem. Greed can hide behind those virtues. And I think because greed is so hard to spot, it is so elusive, so tricky to see, that's the reason why Jesus gives this warning. Beware. Guard against every kind of greed. Life is not measured by how much you owe. So Jesus not only gives the warning, but do you notice? He kind of defines and describes what the focus is for people who struggle with greed. It's their possessions. It's their stuff. It's the things they owe that gets their focus and attention. And because greed is such an elusive element in our lives that can hide behind such good virtues, I think that's the reason why Jesus not just gave a warning, but wanted to tell a story, because maybe through this story, we'll begin to see greed just might be hiding in our heart. So remember the story. It's of a man who is a very wealthy landowner already, and he planted a crop, and it was just one of those abundant years. He had a true abundance, and good for him. So what did he decide to do? He decided to plan, didn't he? How am I going to save all of this abundance? I'll know what I'll do. I got to tear down these barns and build even bigger ones. And then, I'll be able to be secure in my future. I'll be able to sit back and enjoy life. Now remember what the three virtues are that are so positive that guilt can hide behind. First, there is saving. And as we see, this man wanted to save all of his abundance. We also know that greedy people can be planners. And we see he was planning, wasn't he? He planned out how he was going to keep all this abundance. And we also saw the other positive virtue, preparing for one's future, one's retirement. And that is what this man was thinking about. Then if I do all these things, save and plan in this way, then I'll be able to prepare and just enjoy my latter years of life. Now, if Jesus had not given the warning he did, we would look at such a parable like this and say, this is how we need to live. Because this would be a model of how to be a good steward of what Jesus provides. To save, to plan, and to look after our future. But, Jesus told this parable to show that there was greed hiding behind all these wonderful virtues. And you might be saying to yourself, I don't see it, Dean. Where was greed hiding? Do you know where it was hiding? The fact that he did not acknowledge that God had something to do with the abundance. Because here's the reality for farmers. They are the hardest workers. The hours they put in, they deserve bountiful crops. But they also know this. There are so many factors that are beyond their control. Farmers can't control how much or how little rain fall on the crops. Farmers can't control how many sunny days there are and how many overcast and rainy days there are. Farmers can't control if a storm comes in and maybe destroys a crop. There are so many factors that are beyond a farmer's control. And you would think that if this landowner was truly thankful to God, don't you think he would have acknowledged that God was the one who was responsible for this abundance? But maybe you might be thinking, what if he did, Dean? Maybe Jesus just forgot to add that. Maybe he's not as greedy as you think, Dean. Okay. If we want to go down that path, then let me ask this question. So then why didn't he say, God, what do you want me to do with all this abundance? Did he acknowledge that God gave him the abundance? Did he ask God, what should I do with this abundance? Not according to the way Jesus told this parable. And why did he not do this? For this reason. Greed says, I owe me. He saw this abundance and he said, I owe it all to me. That is greed. And you see how greed was hiding behind those wonderful virtues. Now, he not only failed to acknowledge that God was the source for his abundance, this very wealthy man forgot something else, that God is the one who determines how long each of us live. Because remember what Jesus said, "You fool, you will die this very night. Then who will get everything you worked for?" This man was forgetting that, wasn't he? He was thinking he still had many years to live. He could sit back and enjoy the easy life. What he failed to acknowledge is that God is the one who sets the time for when we are born and when we die. That's what he failed to acknowledge. And as a result, a very important question is being asked, isn't it? Then who will get everything you worked for? Were we given the answer? No. Because the answer is very evident, isn't it? Somebody else will get everything he worked for. That he will not be given any opportunity to decide how he would distribute, how he could give away the abundance that he had worked for. As we see in this parable, it points out a truth and reality in life, doesn't it? That we are reliant on God for our abundance, all that we have. And we're also reliant on God for how long we can live on this earth. And as we experience our abundances, as we live out our days, we have to make a decision and choice, don't we? Who will get everything we have worked for? Will we make that decision? Or will we wait till it's too late and die? And then somebody else will get everything we worked for. That's just the truth and reality of life. And then Jesus went on to give this definition of a greedy person. Yes, a person is a fool to store up earthly wealth, but not have a rich relationship toward God. That basically summarizes what a greedy person is in Jesus' eyes. That the person is so focused on stuff that they don't have a rich relationship with God. And when you look at this man in the parable, doesn't that describe him? He failed to have a rich relationship with God. Do you remember what I said earlier? That maybe when we started this sermon, you're thinking to yourself, this doesn't apply to me. You know, Dean, I can get anger, I can get guilt, but no, I don't have any greed. But maybe right now, after hearing all this, you're all of a sudden feeling uncomfortable. That maybe you're beginning to think, you know what? I'm a saver. You know what? I'm a planner just like him. You know what? I prepare hard and have thought out my retirement and set enough aside. And remember, these are good virtues, and I do all the same things. But, you might be beginning to realize that these virtues are hiding greed. That maybe deep down inside, there is greed in your heart. And what is the driving force behind greed? Do you know what it is? Fear and worry. That we're afraid that God may not be as abundant to us as we move ahead. Or that God may not abundantly keep up with the lifestyle that we are so accustomed to. Do you see what happens with fear? All of a sudden, we're beginning to question God. Okay, God, I know you have provided in the past, but will you continually keep this abundance? And when we question that, when we fear that, that's when we begin to have greed, begin to store up earthly things and not be in a rich relationship toward God. As we saw in the first two attributes, when it came to guilt, Jesus had a remedy. And his remedy was confession and repentance. When it came to anger, Jesus had another remedy, and that was forgiveness. So, when it comes to greed, does Jesus have a remedy as well? Of course he does. He's the great physician. And Jesus' remedy when it comes to getting rid of greed is this: generosity. Now, isn't it appropriate and fitting that it's on Thanksgiving Sunday that we're talking about generosity? Because this is the time of year where we are thankful for all our blessings, all that God has done for us. But how do we truly become generous people? You know, some are just so natural at it, but for some of us, maybe it's more of a struggle. And especially if greed is hiding behind those attributes, it's even going to be more of a struggle to be generous. So, how do we become generous? How do we learn generosity? Well, the first step we need to do is this. We need to stop and ask God, how does he want you to share your abundance? Because remember, that is the one thing this man failed to do. To just look at his abundance and say, God, I know this is all coming from you. What do you want me to do with this abundance? Do you see what can happen if we stop and pause and do this? You know, isn't it interesting, whenever we're in need, we don't hesitate to go to God and ask God, I'm in need, can you help me? But how many times when we're in abundance do we go to God and ask that question, what do you want me to do with your abundance you have just given me? If we do this, we're going to begin to see things through God's eyes and God's perspective and begin to understand, what is he trying to say? What does he want to do by being so generous towards us? And one thing we'll see from God's perspective is he wants us to develop generosity too. Just as he is generous toward us, aren't we to develop divine attributes like generosity as well? So we'll begin to see. That's why God is blessing me with abundance. He wants me to develop generosity. And we'll also see something else from God's perspective. Sharing. As I said in that story time, what would God want if we have an abundance of things? And if we start seeing others with nothing, wouldn't he want us to share our cookie? Wouldn't he want us to share some of our abundance with others? As you can see, if we start with this question, God, what do you want me to do with your abundance? We'll begin to develop generosity. But we have to do something else. Not just ask God, but as God directs us, we need to do this. Start giving. Because we can't become generous people without giving. You know, it doesn't work this way. God, make me a generous person, and then I'll start giving. That's the same as thinking, you know, I want to be fit, so God, make me fit, and then I'll begin to exercise. It doesn't work that way, does it? You exercise, then you become fit. It's the same with generosity. You start giving, and then you become more generous. And where do you start? Start by being a percentage giver. Start tithing. Oh, I know that's one of those topics that are so uncomfortable, but we want to be rich in our relationship toward God, don't we? Remember, that's Jesus' definition, that if you're a greedy person, you are not rich in your relationship toward God. So we have to be a percentage giver. And I'm not saying start with 10%, because that's a big step for many of you. But why don't you start at 2%? Start giving 2% as a tithe. And then as you do that for a month or two and notice you still have an abundance, then step it up to say 5%. And if you try that for a few months and you notice you still have an abundance, then you might be willing to go to 10%, what the Bible encourages us, a percentage giver towards spiritual things. Now, have I done this? Yes. And we did it at the most inopportune time, the craziest time that you would think that we would start to begin to tithe. It was when I had to give up my job as an accountant and go back to school to become a minister, 3-year program. We were relying on just my wife's income, but we tithed. We tithed the 10% and we trusted God. And even though my expenses were $10,000 a year for school, do you know the amazing thing because we began to tithe? God blessed us in abundance. Do you know our bank account never went down during that time? Our bank account went up. That's what happens when you become a percentage giver. You become generous toward God. God becomes generous toward you. But as we see, we can't just be a percentage giver. If we're going to be generous, we also need to be a spontaneous giver. Because there'll be times when God will give us that nudge. There'll be times when somebody is brought into our presence and you know this is of the Lord's doing. And that the Lord is saying, this person is in need. I want you to give. I remember one such time. It was not long after I came here. I received a phone call one night and somebody was needing medicine for their young daughter. And you know, they said, you know, we need $20 just to get this medicine. So I drove over to their house and when they were giving me directions, they said, you know, you'll see a Hummer in our driveway. Now, I don't drive a Hummer, and I'm sure you don't drive a Hummer. But when I got there and gave the $20, you know, I was driving home and I'm thinking, God, they probably got the money. Why? Why did you ask me, you know? And then I got that nudge. And God said, because I knew you would say yes. Obviously, he was up to something. Obviously, he was wanting to show this family that the Lord's children are rich toward him and rich towards others. And that is generosity. When we become a percentage giver and when we become a spontaneous giver for God. As we saw in today's sermon, we may have never, ever imagined or considered that greed might be hiding in our heart. But maybe it is. Maybe it was so hidden you didn't see it behind all those good attributes. And if it is hiding there, God is saying to you today, you owe it to yourself. You owe it to others. And you owe it to me, God himself, to get rid of it. And how do we become generous? Simple. By asking God, what do you want me to do with the abundance? And saying, God, I will give. All you need to do is direct me. Let me ask you, when God calls you home, will you want to be known as a greedy person or as a generous person that had a rich relationship with the Lord? An interesting question, an important question to truly answer. God bless. And amen. Let us sing our next hymn, Thank You, Lord, for Your Blessings on Me. come before God, shall we, in our prayers on this Thanksgiving weekend. Heavenly Father, we are just so thankful because this Thanksgiving is very different from a year ago. Where a year ago, we weren't allowed to have people come over and gather in our houses. This year we can, but safely. And we know, God, that we're going to appreciate this gift, especially if we can have loved ones over with us and do so in a way that we keep one another safe. So we thank you for this Thanksgiving Sunday. We just pray for blessings on all who might be traveling this weekend. And we just ask that it'll be a time to pause to give thanks to you, a God who gives so abundantly to us, a God who is so rich towards us, a God who is so faithful each and every day in providing. So we just ask, God, that help us to be thankful people and generous people. Because we've learned this day, God, that it's so easy to become greedy without even realizing it. So may we follow your example and be people of generosity. We remember in our prayers this day, God, those who are going through illness. We know many are going through health matters right now. Some have COVID, some have cancer, some have heart issues, some have recoveries from surgeries. We pray for all who are going through these situations, God. And we remember our sister in Christ, Amy, and just ask that you be with her and continue to help her on the healing journey. Bless all who are struggling with health matters, with the healing they desire. We pray for those who are grieving. We know many have lost loved ones. Many might be grieving the loss of work, the loss of experiences, the loss of opportunities. Be with all who are grieving at this time, God, and lift their spirits and souls. We pray with those who are struggling emotionally, whether young and old, no matter what stage of life. We know that they can be struggling with anxiety or depression or worry and fears. Help those who are struggling, God, in these ways to know there is always hope and help in you. We pray as well for our indigenous community. We know, God, that we've just come through the National Day of Truth and Reconciliation. We know that the pain is very real for those from residential schools. And we just continue to offer up our prayers for those who have experienced the atrocities and hurts of that time. We pray as well, God, for our leaders. We know it's been a long time through COVID, what they have gone through. And we know that there's still so many decisions that have to be made. Help our leaders, God, to turn to you for the wisdom they need. And we pray for our healthcare workers. We know that as exhausted and tired as we are of COVID, how much more they must be. So we just ask God for your hand upon them, to give them the patience, to give them the strength, to give them the well-being they need at this time. Thank you for this wonderful season. Thank you for this wonderful time of year. May our focus be on you, and may we always say thank you, Lord, for each and every day. In Christ's name we pray. Let's join Amen. In our closing hymn, Thank You, Lord, on this day. for being part of our Thanksgiving service. I really hope that you've enjoyed the decorations of this season. I really hope that you've enjoyed this time of worship. And I hope that you enjoy however you are celebrating the Thanksgiving season. It is always an honor and a pleasure and a privilege to be able to offer our online worship to you. So tune in next week as well. And if you know of people who could be blessed by our ministry here at Mount Pleasant, share with them as well, because this is a wonderful way that you can witness. The benediction followed by "Let there be peace on earth," and then "O Canada," as our tribute to our frontline workers. May the Christ who walked on wounded feet walk with each one of you. May the Christ who served with wounded hands reach your hands out to serve. May the Christ who loved with a wounded heart fill your hearts with love. And as you leave this time of worship, may you see the face of Christ in everyone you meet. And may everyone you meet see the face of Christ in you. God bless, and have the most blessed of week. Amen.